We have three papers, and we have, we'll start with, I think, Ryan's paper, and then we'll go to Enrique and Jean's, and then we'll, and then Ana Julia, finally. I think we should aim for 15 minutes each, if you think that's possible, and you know, try to compress as you can, and we'll go ahead and begin with Ryan.
So I'm presenting a paper that Derek Jinks and I wrote, and unfortunately, just at the last minute, Derek was not able to make the conference. But I wanted to present the paper just by mainly walking through the ways in which the logic of the paper operates, and just to start out by saying that the idea behind the paper is what some of you, I think, might have anticipated. We're trying to employ the kind of theoretical model that we've developed around mechanisms of social influence, highlighting the third mechanism that you see in the table on the screen of acculturation, and thinking through how this form of social influence or socialization might operate in the context of research and policy recommendations on the effects of treaty ratification. And what we're doing is trying to utilize the existing empirical research that gets at these questions. And what we first do in the paper is to suggest that the current research is lacking in many respects, and some of the best state-of-the-art research is, in fact, Beth's book. And that might be, especially to this audience, you would already think about and know that that's potentially counterintuitive, because Beth's book is more, as Beth says explicitly in the conclusion, a liberal internationalist model that emphasizes or foregrounds domestic politics, but acculturation is not based on self-interest or instrumental calculations based on self-interest of actors or as rational actors, and it's certainly not a causal pathway that emphasizes the domestic. Rather, it emphasizes the international or transnational elements. But the idea behind the paper is, as in some respects this conference embodies, to integrate them. So it's supplemental. It's certainly not substituting for alternative models. And it's to say that acculturation needs to be taken very seriously as an important mechanism. And then the way in which we study treaty effects and make policy recommendations would take it into account. It also, in a way, I think is important, because I do think that Beth's right in the book to say that some of the existing literature in world culture literature, or global polity literature, whatever one might call it, does not seriously take into account domestic politics. And the idea behind this paper, I think, as is written throughout the paper, is that it can incorporate and integrate with elements of domestic politics and disaggregation of the state. And I'll say more about that as we go along. And the implications, as I've already mentioned, are both for researchers, but also for policy. So just to spell out a little bit the table, there are the three mechanisms, material inducement, persuasion, and acculturation. Our argument is, in part, that much of the literature either overlooks or conflates acculturation with other forms of social influence. The first form is material inducement, which is very straightforward. It's about power relationships and states making their determinations or state actors on the basis of survival or resources. It's an instrumentalist logic. You change their behavior by changing their cost-benefit calculation. The forms of influence are material, rewards and punishments. Sticks and carrots is, in other words, changing the price for a state to engage in a particular behavior changes the behavior. And the outcome is one of compliance or capitulation. Economic boycotts as a stick, or the Millennium Challenge, which has already been mentioned earlier, as a carrot, the Bush administration is giving millions of dollars to states that would improve their human rights practices. Persuasion and acculturation are different. You can actually change the underlying preferences and interests of a state. And this is where it becomes a little bit more difficult, but not so much so, to distinguish between the two. And that's part of the point, that many scholars refer to persuasion, but they're at the same time talking about shaming mechanisms, and other ideas or processes that are dependent upon status and social status. But instead, when we look at what the real meaning is, real by what social psychologists and psychologists would say is the meaning of persuasion, it operates according to a particular logic that's different from the logic of acculturation. The conceptual touchstone for persuasion is that the content of the idea is what's important, and the congruence between that idea and one's existing value framework will determine whether or not an actor adopts that belief. The validity of the rule is central in terms of the behavioral logic, and it's an active assessment of the validity of the rule. The forms of influence are the techniques of framing, for example. So some of Keck and Sickink's work here that trades on the social psychological dynamics of framing are important. So social psychologists talk about whether or not the message has resonance with the audience. For example, its centrality to the audience's existing framework, the relationship between the message or the content of the idea and the experiences of the audience or the target for the persuasive ideal. And the idea here is that the result is a true acceptance and internalization and a change of the mind. Acculturation is different. It relates not to the content of the idea, but the relationship between the target and their reference group. That's what's much more important. So it's in some sense about social expectations that are placed on members of a group, or not just social expectations, but cognitive frameworks. So what does it mean to be a modern state might also be a cognitive idea, or does a modern state have a central independent bank, as one empirical study documents, is another reflection of this mechanism of influence. The idea here is that we also we break apart the notion of social pressures from cognitive pressures. So some of this is about social role and social status, but some of it is also about cognitive, much more deeply taken for granted norms. The end result we talk about as being about conformity or conformity, in which often you'll get policy changes or. And an individual acting under pressure of a social group might change their outward performance, but private deviance will still persist. So you might get fair trial rights in constitutions around the world, but look at the actual trials, and there's decoupling between the formal change and the change on the ground. That, importantly, I should add, is not a necessary component of acculturation, but it's a good empirical test of the presence of acculturation, because it distinguishes it from persuasion, where you have a deeply internalized norm. Acculturation might also take place as a cognitive framework, for example, in which it's a taken-for-granted norm that states internalize. So there's some studies of the ideology of science and progress that states buy into as a cognitive framework is not one in which you'd see significant decoupling, but then it's very difficult empirically to test between whether or not that's being produced and diffused across states through persuasion or acculturation. So decoupling is rather the empirical footprint that can demonstrate the effect or importance of acculturation. So in the piece what we try to do is work through three different parts. The first part is to look at the evidence of acculturation in the context of treaty ratification, where we express some dissatisfaction with the existing literature and turn significantly to Beth's book, but integrate Beth's book with some other empirical research that's being conducted. And at the same time that we also don't necessarily accept Beth's theoretical explanation of some of the findings at face value, there's some contestation and points of disagreement between us on that. So the first area of study is about treaty commitment. Just having spoken with Jose before this panel, I think he's also going to talk a little bit more about if we are going to understand the effects of treaty ratification, we also want to look first at why states ratify in the first place. So you have to, and Jose will talk more about that, but we also think that it's very important that you would understand the social logics that are pressuring states to ratify treaties will be an important matter for then thinking about what are the social logics that define their compliance or effects of treaty ratification. But the first point here is to demonstrate that through Beth's book, there's a wealth of evidence in support of acculturation as an important mechanism behind state motivation to ratify treaties. First is the finding that the greater degree to which a state is embedded in the international legal order is a strong, very strong predictor as to whether or not the state will ratify. For example, the International Covenant on Economic and Social Rights and CEDAW and CAT, there's a 23% more likelihood, the greater degree to which the state is embedded in the world society, that they'll ratify the Economic and Social Rights Covenant, 12% greater likelihood they'll ratify CAT, 20% greater likelihood that they'll ratify CEDAW. And that's a very similar kind of an independent variable that's taken up by some of the Stanford School global polity scholars. The level of integration with the society is a good predictor as to whether or not the actor will take on the societal norms. There are other indicators that Beth also uses. So for example, she looks at whether or not regional human rights norms are strongly correlated with a strong predictor of ratification of that norm. She uses a regional indicator for political rights within a region. She also uses another independent variable, the indicator of the acceptance of government involvement in the market. And that is a strong predictor of whether an individual state will ratify the two covenants. And in fact, it's 43% more likely that a state will ratify the ICCPR based on that independent variable, and a 52% likelihood that it will not ratify the Economic and Social Rights Covenant based on that regional norm. Third, and probably the one that's received the most attention of readers, is the social pressure or social camouflage account. The idea here is that the greater density of regional ratifications is a strong predictor as to whether or not a state will ratify a human rights instrument. The idea that Beth explains is one that Derek and I generally agree with. It's a socialist camouflage account that it's difficult to be an outlier. And if you remain one of the laggards, there's going to be a lot of pressure placed upon you. So states follow the norm or join the bandwagon because other states within the region are doing so. Just a quote from Beth's book, so to pin her down in her what she can say in discussion comments, is she says, governments sometimes ratify human rights treaties because they want to enjoy praise and acceptance and avoid criticism. That is why they often respond to the social pressure to ratify when countries in the region begin to do so. In the short run, this is completely understandable. It's difficult for rights activists to single out one country for criticism. When an entire region remains aloof from a treaty regime, laggards are much easier to target and credibly to shame than are actors that behave like everyone else. This is perhaps why there is such a strong tendency for the decision to ratify to be influenced by ratification patterns within one's own region. Now, here comes a point of disagreement. I think we totally agree on that. Beth says that the findings, also a second level of findings, show divergence, that even though you have this regional ratification effect, you find that the actual practices of states within the region diverge from their ratification effect. And Beth utilizes that to disprove socialization. Our argument is it would disprove persuasion or deep internalization, but it's actually consistent with an affirmative evidence of decoupling. Because you get the strong isomorphic structural conformity to the treaty regime, but you still get divergence on the ground. And Beth also independently disproves a material inducement account. So in a certain sense, you're left with the residual category of acculturation. Another finding in Beth's book that is more difficult for us to grapple with, and I think does challenge both a persuasion-based account and an acculturation-based account, is the finding that that a state's ratification does not correlate with the increased density of opportunities for persuasion. In other words, increased density of opportunities for persuasion, I would even just say increased density of opportunities for socialization, persuasion and acculturation, so the number of meetings that states have to codify new human rights norms, you would think would be associated with social conformity to the norm. This is also trades a little bit on, I would say, Jason Beckfield's terrific article on regional networks rather than global networks for global polity scholarship. And you would think that the density of the regional network would correlate with the spread of the regional norm, and it doesn't in this instance. Our thought about that is it does disprove regional ratification with respect to states being influenced directly by the practices of their other states, that they're not necessarily convinced to abide by a certain ratification norm because other states in the region are convincing them of such, but it still is consistent with a social camouflage account that the pressure is coming globally. That international actors, the UN, Human Rights Watch, Federation International, the FIDH for the French version of Amnesty International, are placing pressure on states, and states have less wiggle room if they are the outliers within their region, but they have a greater excuse to say, if other states are not ratifying either, that they can, they don't have to succumb to that pressure. Similarly, it's a domestic politics story, which would also suggest that when domestic actors pressure their states to ratify because of a global norm, they are empowered by the fact that regional actors have already ratified, and they are disempowered by the fact that regional actors aren't. So those are the direct sources of pressure and influence, domestic actors utilizing the regional norm or international actors, even though we admit that it might mean that in that instance, regional states are not directly influencing those the other states. There's also some evidence in Beth's qualitative analysis. So in the case of Japan, there's references to the argument by domestic groups that if Japan didn't first sign CEDAW, then it would put the nation in shame, is the quote unquote. And then after they signed CEDAW, then the major determinant, according to Beth, and I think this is right according to the case study, is national shame once again. Once they signed it, there's for consistency and reputational concerns, which Mike Toms identifies in his paper, there was also this idea that they would have to go forward and ratify because of the reputational concern. This is also consistent with Brian Simpson's study of the delay of the United Kingdom for signing up to the Genocide Convention, and Derek and my attention was brought to that work, coincidentally, through Jose Alvarez. But the documentation by Brian Simpson is fascinating in terms of the British government, at least the foreign ministry, being highly concerned about Britain being an outlier on the Genocide Convention. And then finally, there's an alignment between the Home Office and the Foreign Ministry, and their statements made, for example, by a joint memorandum in which they say that the accession to the Genocide Convention would be, quote, if they don't do it, it would be useful propaganda of the communists if we fail to support a measure which had on the face of it such laudable intentions and had already been accepted for all its limitations by 38 states. And there's similar language to that about why would we want to be aligned with South Africa and the Slav countries in one direction or the other that come out of the historical archival record. So it's consistent with that as well. It's also consistent with Ian Allison Johnson's work on China and social states, in which he finds that China agrees to international arms control agreements because its foreign ministry wants to push it in that direction, even though the People's Liberation Army would go in a different direction. So that's some of the instances in which I think that it demonstrates it across other cases. Let me skip to what we think is the cash value for the treaty effects question. And there are just a few of these, but I think they're important. The first is a vertical effect. So this is something we've already talked about with Mike Tom's paper. The greater degree to which states have already ratified the agreement might have a different social effect within the country that then ratifies it. And it would be good for researchers to check the density or the life cycle of the treaty regime as a part of the independent variable. Second point is that the same elements of acculturation that go into ratifying go into compliance. So Japan, again, from the case study, it's talked about as being an item of national shame if Japan doesn't already reform its legislation to be in compliance with CEDAW on the date of its ratification. So a similar social logic. Third is we think that there's good evidence to say that acculturation creates some of the preconditions for treaty effects. So this means that Beth's findings that it's important if a country has an impartial court and a strong rule of law. Well, where does that come from, that they have an impartial court and fair rule of law? Well, there are other findings in the book that show that fair trial rights diffuse through a social contagion effect. So part of our point is that acculturation sets the preconditions for the effectiveness of some of these treaties. CEDAW is about a mobilization story, but where did women get the right to enter into the electoral process as well as the right to education? There's strong evidence in Beth's book, there's strong evidence in the world culture literature that suffrage for women and rights to education have diffused through an acculturation mechanism. So that's a precondition. The last two points I would highlight are, I think, more counterintuitive in a sense. One is the effects of ratification, not just on states that haven't ratified, which we could talk about that as as a horizontal effect, but also on court decisions, even if the country hasn't ratified. And what we do here is utilize certain landmark opinions in the United States Supreme Court and also in the Court of Appeals in the Philadelphia ATCA litigation, in which the courts refer to treaties that the United States has yet to ratify, but say that this is evidence of a world public opinion. Look at how many states have ratified the ICCPR or the Convention on the Rights of the Child for the Juvenile Death Penalty, even though the United States is an outlier, or even though the United States has ratified the ICCPR, but with a reservation on the juvenile death penalty. So it's about that global pressure to the point that some conservative constitutional law scholars have criticized the court for quote-unquote nose counting and calling it a denominator problem, that they just, as soon as they have a certain number of denominator, then they switch or are influenced by that. And even the argument that, but I think this is micro-phenomenological to too great a degree, Justice Kennedy has been spending too much time in the south of Spain with other judges from around the world. Okay, so it's rubbed off on him. So the last point is, especially because of these horizontal effects, the policy recommendation. Both Beth's book, Ona Hathaway's work, and Anne Bayefsky say that we should target particular states and not go for universal ratification. That's already been mentioned with respect to Beth's book, that she says you should target the transitional countries, so that residual category. Our argument is that it needs to be much more universal. The fact that it has an effect in the transitional countries might be because of the density of ratifications from these other countries in the first instance, so that vertical effect is important. Secondly, the horizontal effect has to be taken into account. So we don't just want those transitional countries to ratify. We want high levels and dense networks of either regional actors or industrialized democracies, whatever we think the relevant peer group is, to ratify a convention to have effects in states that might never ratify or enter that regime, which would be another instance of how you would target it for more the standard and same old universal ratification rather than these more narrow policy recommendations.
Very good. Okay, So how about Jean and turn to, we'll turn to the paper now by Jean and Enrique. And do you guys just want to get on both sides then? Or do you want to be together? What do you prefer?
That's okay.
Okay.
I'll stay here.
Do you have anything to put in here?
No.
All righty.
Okay, well, first, thanks to Ryan and Beth for the invitation. It is a pleasure to be here, and we learned a lot from the debate and discussion. This is our paper is a part of a research project that initially started as a one country, one convention study, the role of the convention, or the impact, or domestic impact of the Convention of the Rights of the Child in Argentina, but that we are began to expand it, but to include other countries in Latin America, and eventually we are planning to develop a comparative project that involves different international human rights treaties and a different range of countries. So suggestions and on how to go about it in the future are most welcome. We focus on one problem that has come out repeatedly in the debates yesterday and today, and this is the gap between global and norms and domestic norms. And we focus on what are the effects of ratification on domestic politics. And particularly, we focus on what we term the politics of compliance. We think that the politics of compliance can be understood as a subset of human rights politics, where what is at stake is not a struggle over the legitimacy of human rights norms. The classical human rights struggles took place in a political context that usually was hostile to the discourse of human rights, and in which civil society actors and human rights networks were facing an authoritarian state that not only rejected the legitimacy of human rights discourses, but that was actually perpetrating gross human rights abuses. So what is at stake in this subset of human rights politics is not so much the question of the overall legitimacy of human rights, or of the overall legitimacy of a particular international human rights treaty, but rather how to translate global norms into domestic policy. So most of the struggle within the compliance politics refers to this problem of translation. Well, how does an abstract norm translate into a specific public policies, into a specific institutional reform, into legislation. So what we have is that, therefore, the politics of compliance takes place in a very different regional and domestic scenario, where the state not only is not hostile to human rights norms, but in a region like Latin America, post-democratization Latin America, most states have openly embraced human rights discourses, leading to a enormous cascade of ratifications of a large number of international human rights treaties. So the struggle on over in the politics of compliance is rather over the meaning, interpretation, and the reach of a ratified international human rights treaty for existing legislation, for institutional practices, for public policies, etc. And we argue that actually compliance and the politics of compliance is shaped by the specificities of local politics, by the specificity of the local political culture, of local institutional arrangements, and the difference across countries in this matter will lead to a very different compliance path even within the region. We have chosen an international human rights treaty like the Convention of the Rights of the Child that is a very comprehensive and a very complex treaty, and therefore that potentially opens up a demand for a broad agenda of institutional change that leads to changes in state institutions that are related to social services, the educational system, the welfare system, to the criminal justice system, the police courts, prisons, etc. And therefore, that this treaty opens up multiple areas of eventual legislative, institutional, and policy reform. We had focused, or at least in this paper, emphasized three variables that we think are relevant. The first one, and follow with Beth's distinction, whether the state is a true or a false ratifier. Second, the strength and makeup of the compliance coalition, and here we understand the compliance coalition not only as involving civil society networks, but also the state, and certain sectors of the state can be part or in some occasions lead the compliance coalition. And the third variable is where there are some intense disagreements over specific aspects of an international human or specific provisions of international human rights treaty. So we think that according to how these variables play, we will have different national paths to ratification, that they differ regarding the timeline of the process of participation, of the scope of reforms, and finally on different emphasis on particular areas and particular policies. So.
Okay. Right. Okay, I think I've probably got 5 minutes in which I'm supposed to explain how these three cases actually worked out. So, I mean, the difficulty of conveying this kind of research in 5 minutes is pretty intense. Before I do, I think it's just worth noting that our view, our kind of hypothesis, actually shifted as we developed the research, because when we picked up the first case study, this is unusual, I think, in that we started with one very, very deep case study, Argentina. And what Argentina really shows, as I'll try and explain in a sec, is that mobilization matters, that civil society mobilization matters. So we started thinking of compliance coalitions, of compliance politics, as being essentially driven by mobilization. And then when we broadened the case studies, I'm just going to present evidence from three, but we did have another case in there. What the other cases clearly showed is the significance of the state in terms of its sincerity, the sincerity of the state on ratification, but also the degree to which specific state actors were willing to get involved in the pursuit of compliance, that the extent to which they were prepared to join, as it were, a compliance coalition. So here we go, three very quick cases. Ecuador figures as a sincere ratifier, that is, ratification was, Ecuador was the first country in Latin America to ratify, and I think the third globally. There was an expectation within the state that ratification would make a difference to public policies in some way. There was a real, at the same time, the compliance coalition in Ecuador was driven, for particular reasons to do with Ecuadorian politics that I won't get into here, was very driven by very strong pro-rights NGOs, pro-children's rights NGOs in particular. So what all this actually meant is that the NGO community in Ecuador, with the sympathy of the state, but nonetheless the NGO community largely became the translator of what the convention would mean in national politics. And so what we've seen in Ecuador is a series of initiatives which are probably deeper than in the other two coalitions, the other two countries, where we've got kind of children's consultations, we've got sets of legal reform, we've got constitutional reform in 2008 that recognises children specifically as part of the national community, and that lowers voting age. Okay, so that's Ecuador in a nutshell. Chile, mixed coalition, compliance coalition, slower timeline,
and a case where there is some degree of ideological conflict around what children's rights mean, quite deep conflict, actually, in Chile about what that should mean. And that's played out in very particular ways in Chile. Chile avoided incorporating the convention into national law, which has happened in most other countries in Latin America, primarily because of the divisive nature of children's rights. But what has happened is that state actors, in particular, in the context of very weak civil society organizations, have taken the lead in defining what children's rights mean. What does compliance mean in Chile? If you speak to Chilean elites, if you speak to governmental elites about that, they'll tell you actually is an anti-poverty agenda. It's not really a rights agenda, or it's an educational agenda. The two become very, very mixed up in the case of Chile. So we do have a set of reforms, although actually I think you've probably got a set of reforms that would have gone on anyway with rights pasted onto them. So a very mixed, very, very confused picture. Argentina, I think, closest to the picture of the false ratifier. Very slow legislative reform, very slow reform in any case. But what's interesting about the Argentine case, I think, is that it picks up something that was said in one of the earlier papers, the idea that conventions and treaties are living instruments. That is, one of the reasons that the Argentine case is so particularly interesting is that we can see shift, we can see change, we can see movement in what compliance actually means. So from ratification in 1991, by 2005, we're starting to see actually some kind of legal change happening. So it is quite interesting. Argentina, also a case where we have very strong, very deep, very open ideological conflict around the meaning of children's rights. I'm sure I could go into a lot more detail if you ask me in questions, but I'll stop there with the cases. But I just want to highlight some issues that Enrique and I think come out of the case that maybe we would like some guidance on and we'd like some discussion on. I think the first is you know, a general discussion about what does compliance mean in cases like the Convention for Children's Rights, where it really is up for discussion domestically, how you interpret that convention. What do things like best interests of the child mean? How are we going to determine when a country is in compliance or not? And I don't think that, you know, the Convention on the Rights of the Child is not the only convention that falls into that category. So that's the first issue. The second issue, I think, is kind of a methodological issue, which, again, we would appreciate some guidance on. How do we take it forward? You know, should we take this forward by moving out of Latin America? Should we take it forward by bringing in cases which are not necessarily as sympathetic to international human rights discourses as Latin America is? Would that be an appropriate comparison? How do we take it forward in terms of bringing in other conventions or other treaties? And, you know, a general discussion really about the appropriate method for capturing this kind of compliance politics that we're talking about. Thanks.
Okay, my paper is close to being a one convention, one country study, but I'm including Sweden and Finland as contrasting cases, because this particular convention, the ILO Convention 169 on indigenous and tribal peoples, has been ratified by Norway, but not, at least not so far, by Sweden and Finland. So by including the Swedish and Finnish case, you may also get an idea about how the treaty ratification imposes a particular dynamics on domestic politics that is present in Norway, but is absent in Finland and Sweden. Okay, this particular convention is the only international human rights treaty that explicitly aims at regulating the relationship between states and indigenous peoples. And as the very first state, Norway ratified this particular convention in 1990, 1 year after its final adoption. The decision to ratify was based on the assumption that Norway's domestic law fulfilled the requirements of this particular convention, including its requirements on land rights. And the decision was also, although more indirectly, based on the assumption that the ratification would not affect the work of the so-called Sami Rights Commission. 15 years later, in June 2005, the Norwegian Parliament passed the so-called Finnmark Act. And this act assigned a registered title to land in Norway's northernmost county, Finnmark, that was previously owned by the state, to the new body, the Finnmark Estate. This is an area that amounts to approximately 1.5 times the area of Belgium, so it's a significant area. This particular landowner, the Finnmark Estate, is by far Norway's largest landowner. And the paper basically takes us through the process whereby this happened. And I try to demonstrate that both the content of this particular act, as well as the process that preceded it, was significantly affected by the ratification in 1990 in ways that were clearly not foreseen or intended by the Norwegian government. The Finnmark Act, I believe, is a result of a what must be regarded as a tremendously successful mobilization on the part of the Sami Parliament in Norway, closely allied with individual lawyers, and where the content of the treaty was turned against the national government to support what was mainly a regional claim for land rights. So what is interesting about this particular case is the very dynamic interplay between the international level, the international treaty, the national political bodies, most mainly the national government and the Norwegian parliament, as well as the regional level and the Sami level, the ethnic level. The paper is, and I know it, it's underdeveloped and severely underdeveloped theoretically, and I think many more mechanisms may be at work here and may have played a role than the one I've pointed out in the paper, and I would be more than happy to have comments and suggestions for how to improve it on that point. So the Finnmark Act was I see as a basically unintended consequence of the ratification, but there are clear signs that this tremendously successful mobilization in this particular case has been met with counter-mobilizations in the aftermath of the Finnmark Act. This counter-mobilization is particularly evident from the Office of the Attorney General in Norway in cases concerning fisheries and mining. Fisheries and mining issues in Finnmark, as well as the hitherto unresolved issue of Sami land rights south of Finnmark County. So, in a way, it has unintended consequences. The mobilization may have triggered unintended consequences on a later stage as well. So there are unintended consequences on many levels here. A third set of unintended consequences, which are very hard to prove, is, but which are interesting nevertheless, is whether the compliance process or the implementation process in the Norwegian case has affected the prospect of a Swedish and Finnish ratification in the first place. There are clear signs that Swedish governments, well, one thing is for sure, neither the Swedish nor the Finnish government want to do what the Norwegian government did, namely to ratify first and then initiate reforms in the aftermath of ratification. Both the Swedish and the Finnish governments have stated that they have a long-term goal of ratifying the ILO Convention on Indigenous Peoples, but have stated also very clearly that they want to do that as a result of domestic legal change before ratification. So one thing I can say for certain is that the Norwegian process will not be repeated in neither Sweden nor Finland. But there is also a question whether this mobilization and the final result in the Norwegian case may have actually decreased the prospect of a Swedish and Finnish ratification. Not least because Norway and Sweden held similar positions during the ILO negotiations concerning the relation between the right to use a particular area, a particular land, and the right to ownership and possession of the same land. The Norwegian and Swedish position was that the right to use land should be put on a par with the right to ownership and possession, and that was a that position. They left that position in the course of the negotiations because they it was clearly not impossible to reach. It was clearly impossible to reach an agreement on that particular point. Yeah, I think I can make it that.
Okay, great. Thank you. And now we have Jose Alvarez. I think that Jose is going to concentrate on Jean and Enrique's paper, and then I'm going to respond to Ryan and also to your paper as well. And you can stay here, yeah, on Aurelia's paper.
So it's a pleasure to be here, and I apologize that I wasn't here yesterday. So it is possible that some of my comments will only repeat things that have been already said, and for that I apologize. So this particular paper I found fascinating in part because it certainly connects to the existing implementation literature, not just the empirical stuff, that is not just Beth Simmons, Ryan Goodman, or Lawrence Helfer's work, but to me it also reminds me of Karen Knopp's work, that is not empirical, purposely not empirical. And when I heard Enrique mention several times that this is an examination of how we translate international norms into local law, it certainly reminds me of her important point that the translation itself is not necessarily easily measurable in terms of compliance, which I heard Jean repeat in her part. So that there's a tension, I think, between what the paper purports to be doing and what is actually happening. That is, and I heard that tension certainly in your description of Argentina in particular, namely that this is a living, breathing constitutional document, the Rights of the Child Convention, and therefore it is hard to measure, and it's a moving target, as was heard by Professor Ulfstein, to measure this. I am not saying that this kind of empirical work is impossible or not useful, but it is has to be extremely carefully done, so that my own recommendation would be you better be comparing apples to apples, so that I would prefer you to be comparing the Rights of the Child Convention across countries as opposed to jumping, and I'll address the differences between human rights conventions in a minute. So a couple of specific comments. And that is, as I go through the paper, and then I'll make some general comments at the end. The paper at page 4 tells us that there is a gap between ratification and implementation that needs to be explained and reconceptualized, and that there is then compliance politics. And I realize that the symposium assumes that we should be measuring from the date of ratification forward, and there's lots of good reasons to do that as a particular moment in time. However, there, we should keep in mind that, as I think the other your paper points out, that we need to peek before a ratification to see what's been going on beforehand, not just because a lot of the things that are happening in the societies obviously preceded the convention in terms of conflicts about children's rights, for example, or other things, but because it's possible that the states involved change their position in relevant ways in the course of treaty ratification. The other thing I would point out, that in certain countries like the United States, it is quite likely that ratification and domestic implementation occurs at the very same time. That is, the convention is sent forward along with a set of changes to national law that would accompany it, in which case then the baseline of compliance is not only compliance with the international instrument, the baseline is how well does the state comply with its own national law, not just in this area, but in other areas. So if you're talking about a state that for resource or because of rule of law traditions has trouble complying with its own national law, then all you're measuring is, oh, this is just the same as all the other laws, say, taxes in Argentina, who pays for them, really? Or corruption laws, are they really complied with? So that complicates it. I guess the story that I would say is I don't dispute your three variables. I just think each one of them is enormously more complex. And at least a recognition of that is important. The other thing that I would say when we talk about the politics of compliance, again, it's an ongoing process. The national laws may change over time as well as the attitudes. And that leads to a point, again, at page 5, a tension between what I think the aspiration of the paper is, which is, like Beth's work and like Ryan's work, is to draw generalizations across the planet, and what you find, which is nationally contingent case by case. So there is a tension within the paper itself about what your real goals are. As I see your conclusion at page 5, it's nationally contingent. But you also suggest it may be regionally contingent. And you're also suggesting implicitly there may be some universals that you want to draw from it. And I guess I would press you. You're the empiricist. Which one is it, right? The other suggestion that I would make is that you might want to acknowledge the sort of normative bias in this. That is, at page 6, you say is our aim is to illuminate the process by which international norms give traction to domestic rights demandeurs, contribute to rights-based outcomes in democracies. That is, we have a normative bias in favor of finding certain types of change in a document whose very meaning is heavily contested. So I am not sure that I want to buy into what you think the rights of the child means and whether you are actually measuring some objective notion of that. But and I recognize that different parts of the Rights of the Child Convention are less contestable on that measure than others, but I would want to build that into the paper. That is, what do you think are minimal compliance with this convention, given your reading of it? And that would help, I think, me and others. So that here, what we have at page 8 is a demonstration of freedom from versus rights to the best interests of the child, which triggers to me the following. That is, the Rights of the Child Convention is typical of what I would call human rights conventions that do not recognize rights as trumps. That is, not all rights are trumps. It is an invitation to struggle. The wiggle room is built into almost every provision of this treaty. And so what you're measuring may not always be attempts to wiggle out. It's exactly what the convention invites. And so here are some of the tensions which I think are self-evident, but I think those people who haven't looked at the rights of the child recently may want to be reminded. There is built into the convention a conflict between seeing the rights of a child as an autonomous person subject to being treated equally. And that's all these rights that are very similar to the ICCPR, Articles 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, for example. But there's a tension between that and seeing the child as an entity that needs special protection from the state and special protection with and from their parents, all right? So we have this tension built in. This is the second source of wiggle room now is progressive implementation subject to resources. That part is a little bit like the Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. Third source of wiggle room, respect for culture. Local custom, see Article 5. So therefore, we're saying that maybe these rights are not as universal as, say, the right to be free from torture. Fourth, all appropriate legal, administrative, or other measures, not just subject to resources, but however you want to implement it, depending on different types of national legal structures. And then the fifth, and this is not exhaustive, different levels of rights based on the levels of a child's maturity. So therefore, you evolving capacities of the child, which unlike the 18-year-old cutoff, is not specified by age, but seems to be dependent on the child, right? So that's tremendous room for discretion. I would say that this is a tremendously different instrument from the Convention Against Torture or the ICCPR generally. And it is in between, if you want to look at sort of levels of human rights treaties, with CEDAW being somewhere in the middle, right? That has both equality rights that are hard trumps and then a lot of the progressive stuff built in. So I would distinguish then if I were trying to measure this, and God forbid, I don't even know how to do what Beth does, if I were trying to measure it, I would be very conscious of what treaties are we talking about throughout this. The other thing, and this I do blame Beth for, because I've never understood this in her work, and perhaps she can explain it to me, that is, why is it that we divide states into sincere, this threefold category, when at the same time we are saying that it's all dependent on liberal states? That is, that sounds like the billiard balls are back. That is, states as billiard balls, when we do the trifold division and use that as a method to do that. But maybe I'm missing something, but at least this paper's adaptation of breaking down the three states here into whether they're sincere, false, or somewhere in between seems to fall into that. At the very same time, the rest of the paper is at odds with that, because you're saying it's really, we're not even sure what the state elites are. There's a whole group of entities. So what makes you so sure that the states were or the state, if it is a one entity, was sincere? That is this a balancing test among all the state elites? Isn't it the case that in most of the time you have different parts of the state intending different things, which also gets into the question of, which I think I see in your paper, which is quite common in human rights treaties. That is, regardless of whether the state is sincere or insincere or whatever, its intent is often betrayed by surprise. That is, the surprise of the European Convention suggests to me that maybe the sincerity, if you can measure that, of states is not as relevant a criteria as to the fact that you were surprised by it. And so since I'm about to be kicked off the podium, let me just conclude by saying the sort of five sort of questions I would have. First question, what's the baseline for measuring? That is, national law or not? I think anthropologists like Sally Mary would be curious to see what is it that you're comparing this to. Second, what has been the process before ratification? Because that, I think, would help us to tell us what happens after ratification. Third, the contestation, the invitation to struggle of particular treaties, so that it makes it quite difficult to know what interpretation is outside the bounds to begin with, and some very real care about that. The fourth is this question of why is it that we want to rely on sincere, mixed, and false states, and then at the same time say, but after ratification, we're not going to treat the state in this sort of unitary fashion. And then the fifth is the tension in the project between what the goals might be, which is generalizations versus national case-by-case approach, where you study Argentina, perhaps across different treaties, or regional approaches. You certainly make a lot and probably rightly, conclusions that it's because the region was transitioning to democracy, but that's somewhat at odds with your case-by-case approach. I hope some of that is helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that. All righty, so actually, would you mind telling me when my 15 minutes are up?
Glad to.
So there you go. All righty, so let me start with Anna Julia's very interesting paper. It's a case study about Norway, and it's really an interesting study about unintended consequences. Now, just to point out, there are two kinds of unintended consequences. One is the kind of unintended consequences that Peter Rosendorf works on, and this is an unintended consequence from the point of view of the international community. It's an unintended consequence for the regime formers, if you want to think of it that way. And then there's another kind of unintended consequences, and those are the unintended consequences from the point of view of the actual ratifier. And this is Anna Julia's sort of unintended consequence. And so the unintended from the point of view of the ratifier in this case follows from the fact that they fail to anticipate what the treaty means, and they fail to anticipate how it will be used by domestic groups to get what they want. And so this is a case study about Norway's ratification of the ILO Convention ILO Convention 169, and it represents, of course, this problem that Norway didn't get it right or had unintended consequences. So the first thing that they got wrong was they did not anticipate was what the treaty would mean. It seems to me this is one really central thing here. This is so surprising to me. Norway ratified before they figured out what the treaty would require. Despite unanimous agreement, and then they ask Geir, what does this treaty mean? This to me is shocking and surprising. Why didn't they ask you in the first place, Geir? I mean, it would have been a simple step. Why didn't they pass their domestic legislation and then ratify and then enter a reservation, for example, that the land rights question would be interpreted as consistent with domestic law already in place? That's a completely reasonable, legal sort of turn that they could have taken. So I don't know how to interpret this. Maybe you can speculate a little bit on that in this paper because it shed some interesting light on this broader question. It was the last question that Peter Rosendorf asked me yesterday. Why don't they anticipate the consequences of what they're going to do? And I avoided that question. So one possibility is that Norway is not strategic enough for our theories. That maybe some behaviors are foreclosed to them because of an identity they have as a leader in international law development globally. So this idea, we're not going to ratify and then put some crazy reservation in place that takes it all back, maybe that's off the table for Norway. And maybe you guys can sort of explain that, how that happens. Or maybe someone in Norway is very strategic. And they wanted this outcome. They wanted stronger property ownership rights for the Sami, and they used international law to get it. So I want to know what's going on here in Norway, especially since we got so much detailed information about the actual process that leads up to this very surprising outcome. The second thing that Norwegian leaders evidently failed to anticipate was mobilization potential. So Norway seemed not to anticipate how the public would mobilize upon ratification. This is really hard to imagine. This is an argument I make for transitional democracies where it's sort of not clear how things are really going to work out and there's sort of a lot in flux here, but it's really hard to imagine that ratification would not get groups in Finnmark mobilized. Both the Sami and the local residents who are not Sami that obviously would resist something like this. So it seems to me there's a real puzzle here. Why ratify when you know, or you strongly suspect, or maybe you guys can tell me they didn't even think of this, that there would be strong reaction and inconvenient mobilization for the Norwegian government? And, usually it's some question of flux or uncertainty. But this is not an argument that fits well with my sort of anticipation of what in a democracy should be able to anticipate these kinds of mobilizations. Dictators too can anticipate and they crush or deter, but in a democracy this should all be very predictable. Now there's an interesting example about how the treaty really does seem to grow the coalition from a pro-rights coalition to a pro-compliance coalition, and it's the evidence that supplied that international lawyers like Geir might not have had a strong preference initially about sort of these usufruct versus the ownership paradigm for this law before ratification. Maybe you did, maybe you didn't, I'm not sure. That's not clear in the case study, Geir. But after ratification, he advocated the paradigm that was most consistent with the treaty. So he becomes, and argues that it's very important to comply with that interpretation. And so he becomes part, he joins the pro-rights coalition by adding his voice as a member of the sort of pro-compliance subset of that coalition. Now, the one thing that I think that that you could really make a lot of use of here that you don't yet do, and I know you probably intend to, is this use of Sweden and Finland. Because they do not ratify. And there are interesting opportunities for a lot more comparison here. The similarities are quite stark. There are similar issues before all three countries. There are shared values. There are similar resources and constraints. None of them had ratified the previous convention, 107, a previous accord on a similar issue, all of it viewing it as overly integrationist and paternalistic. But the treatment varies here. So we have ratification in Norway, and we don't have it in Swinland and Sweden. So the question here is Can we use these cases then to argue about the likelihood of the counterfactual? What would have happened in Norway had they not ratified the treaty? So these other countries can serve as baselines or control groups for purposes of sort of anchoring that speculation, because some, of course, might think that the Sami might have been able to assert their rights in Norway even without the ratification. Well, if that doesn't happen in these other two countries, what does that tell us? That the ratification was likely very important in the case of Norway. So some might argue that this was somehow inevitable, but I think if you peer into these really closely, we can find out if ratification is a real spark or not. And the other thing that's quite interesting that you allude to a little bit in your presentation is that Norway's ratification very well could constitute new information for Sweden and Finland about the negative consequences of ratification. See what can happen when you ratify treaties about land rights. They just create controversies and stay away from them. So anyway, I think those are things that you can maybe draw out a little bit more in this paper and speak with an even stronger voice about how you sort of come down on these, on some of these really sort of interesting issues about counterfactuals, about mobilization, about the nature of the coalition, and most importantly, this tremendous mystery about how and why Norway could have gotten this so wrong, and why they didn't put gear onto this in the first place instead of asking him way too late. So the next paper I want to say something about is Ryan and Derek's paper on socialization, the effects of treaty ratification. And their major question here is, how can we explain state compliance with international human rights treaties? And note that there are three distinct mechanisms. Material inducements, like costs, material costs and benefits, persuasion, which is changing one's mind as the result of evidence or of reasoning, and then acculturation, which is social and psychological costs and benefits. So it comprises a wide range of processes, and on the one hand, many are observable. So all the case studies that Ryan talks about involve, you know, fairly obvious efforts at shaming, praising, et cetera. On the other hand, many leave not an empirical trace. Actors are, and this is a quote, impelled to adopt the behavioral practices and attitudes of similar actors in their surrounding social environment, resulting from, continue the quote, varying degrees of cognitive and social pressures, real or imagined, to conform. This is about as between the ears as you will get for a theory. And so acculturation is a conceptually distinct social mechanism, which it doesn't require anybody to apply anything to cause. You have to do nothing to me to get me to turn my cell phone off. That's a bad example. You don't have to do anything to me to get me to comply with certain norms if I just want to be a part of your group, right? You don't have to do anything according to this theory. So it's shaming plus. There are these cognitive processes which even may be imagined. And this has strong implications, they argue, for the way that we design compliance regimes. The bottom line of my comments on this paper is that acculturation probably is a very useful way to think about what might be going on in the area of human rights. For outcomes of ratification, for example, human rights national institutions and constitutions, possibly all of these things. These are areas in which the external material incentives may be very weak. It's hard to think of other drivers for convergence. There are no convincing competitive arguments or negative externality kinds of arguments. And if acculturation applies in any area, we should probably see it in the human rights area. So, you know, whereas other sorts of mechanisms probably operate very strongly with respect to other areas of policy diffusion and convergence, this one seems like a very likely candidate precisely for acculturation. Now, the next part of the paper deals with the evidence of international level acculturation of actors. Now, I think that there may be a risk here in trying to do empirical research on state ratification. I'm afraid that there's a risk that acculturation will become the default explanation because it is very hard to disprove. Material pressures can be tested with ratification on the left-hand side, for example, if you're doing quantitative work in trade, aid, and investment on the right-hand side. Persuasion can be tested empirically through textual analysis or the analysis of the drafting of treaty debates, successive drafts of treaties, and ratification debates. So we can see persuasion going on if we want to carefully read the arguments that are made during these various kinds of debates. But there's a risk that everything that is not materially induced or the result of very clear persuasive argumentation and acceptance becomes acculturation. And the proposition that acculturation is pervasive becomes very hard to disprove. And it's especially true with a particular brand of this argument, this world sociological institutionalism. I'm not quite clear in the paper the extent to which you're associating yourself with that school or drawing on some of the similarities or want to distance yourself from it, because I notice you don't say, this is the approach I'm applying. You notice approvingly that they find many of the same patterns that you're saying reflects acculturation. So this school, the World Sociological Institution School, there is hardly any pattern of behavior, hardly any finding that would not support their theory. So for example, the proportion of global ratifications is evidence. The density of ratifications in a region is evidence. The broad participation in treaties generally, belonging to a lot of organizations and having that predict your ratification behavior, or doing anything that the analyst cannot think of a good functional reason for that becomes evidence of a global script. Okay, so I'm afraid this is quite a default category for almost every kind of convergence that we cannot readily explain by these other two mechanisms. I ran into this a little bit of this problem when I was doing some work on human trafficking. I just need to sort of very quickly say a few things about this. So one can ask, why do states criminalize human trafficking? I was doing some empirical work on this. The world sociological institutionalists would say it's becoming a dominant script, the criminalization of human trafficking, to put it in a sort of criminal prosecutorial kind of framework. So then I said, okay, then patterns of criminalization should be decoupled from the rational need to criminalize, right? And they said, okay, yes, that's what we would predict. Okay, fine. And so then I could show with evidence that criminalization of human trafficking is influenced by the policy of neighbors weighted by trans-border road connections, which conduct their policy externalities from one jurisdiction to another. In other words, I thought I had pointed out something that you would respond to rationally by criminalizing out of fear of that you'll experience the negative externalities from what other countries are doing by virtue of being connected by road. And then the WSI responded, this says, no, this only shows that they're playing out the dominant script, which links human trafficking with transnational crime. So even though I could point out kind of a functional explanation for the pattern I was observing, they shift over to another thing. Oh, no, you're in that paradigm too. You're seeing it through those eyes, you know, and that sort of thing. So every time you think you got something functional, they've got some kind of counter reason for telling you that that's in the world dominant script. So I worry a little bit about this, okay? Now, I'm not saying you're one of them. I just worry you might be getting a little close, that's all. Okay, but so Ryan points out though that the evidence here for these mechanisms tends to be a combination of isomorphism and decoupling. Okay, so similar institutions in place, but a lot of non-compliant actual human rights norms behavior. You know, but a lot of things can explain this pattern. Capacity being the most obvious one. It's hard to come into compliance with human rights norms. What do you think, a government can kind of flip the anti-torture switch and it all gets turned off? I mean, can a government reverse a millennium of social discrimination against women, even in a decade? Probably this is going to be very, very difficult to do. And so decoupling probably occurs because compliance is hard, not because no one's persuaded that these rights are a good thing. So where capacity is a problem, it's really hard to distinguish the acculturation from the persuasion. Now, let me just say, while I am convinced that acculturation is pervasive, I really do think it is, to be honest. I just think we have a hard time with it empirically. And it is precisely because it is between the ears. And so most of our research methods can't get at it. There need be nothing that anybody does to acculturate me. I can just wear, here's one. I mean, I can just wear a style that many of you are wearing, for example. Just because, not, you never told me to. You never told me I looked awful in something else, but I want to fit in. I want to look like you, you know? And so anyway, you didn't have to do anything to me. So there's nothing I can observe that would tell me that I was being acculturated, that would be indicative of that. It doesn't need to involve overt social pressure. It can just be the way I feel when I'm in a group. And the stronger I identify with a group, and the more I want to belong, the less they need to do to me to conform. I do it to myself. And so the cognitive and social pressure can even be imagined. Now, I'm not saying this isn't real. It's just that I worry about how we can falsify this in the context of treaty ratification. And you know, and the answer might be to turn to Mike Toms and say, Mike, what do we do? But the answer to that is we've already done it. We've already done all the experiments on the local between the ears level that show us these things are real. So that work has been done. An earlier version of this paper had a lot of interesting citations about that work to show how real this stuff really is. But the problem is thinking about how it translates into this area of treaty ratification in ways that we can, you know, empirically verify. So public conformity with no private acceptance, but does this category of cognitive pressure even apply to states? Do we have research methods that can get at it? Okay, so maybe I will. Am I out of time?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. But I didn't want to use that sort of hard carrot just to prove your point about 15 minutes.
Oh, okay.
Being socially.
No, thank you there. Well, I just you get my frustration, not with Ryan, but with the literature, that this is an area that it's really hard to disprove. And so all of the things about the similarity within region is not any proof of acculturation. There are just a million other potential explanations for that. We have the same culture. We have the same values. We're about the same GDP. We have the same kind of physical, geographic, similarly kind of constraints. So similarity within region is not strong evidence of acculturation. It's consistent with it, but it's consistent with lots of other things as well. Anyway, that's the gist. I mean, I have a few more things. Maybe I'll come up in question and answer, but. That's what I wanted to
Great.
Say.
So I guess we open it up and you're moderating.
I'm moderating again. All righty. So if you have any kind of response, Xinwan.
Well, just to echo, I think that decoupling, I really also feel that it's not evidence for just acculturation mechanism.
So decoupling, you know, we find it in other areas where, you know, the logic of carrots and sticks applied, over there we see decoupling as well. I mean, the thing that I find really interesting that Beth, you know, did not really emphasize much is this horizontal effect of the treaty ratification or, you know, these international norms. And then so the implication I took out of there is that the, you know, if, so the implication is on legalization. The way I understand it. So we could have these universal norms or with universal participation by states. And if that has to come at a cost of maybe water down the demand codified in the treaty, then you know there's a trade-off. And I think following taking your suggestion very seriously, there's this horizontal effect. Then perhaps one implication is that we could tolerate a lot of these sort of less demanding treaties, but at the same time getting lots of countries in the group because there are these softer effects that, you know, are taking place horizontally. And so if we fold countries in, even if we're not demanding them a great deal, perhaps the effect, this horizontal effect can make up for you know, the less demand. I find that really interesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. Anybody on that particular. You want to jump in there, Tom? Put your mic on.
I haven't been acculturated to the mic thing. you know, I just still don't understand, I still don't get why decoupling is evidence of acculturation, not persuasion. You can imagine a persuasion-based account where decoupling would be evidence for it. And if that, I'd like you to just explain it again, because I don't get it.
Okay. Anybody else want to jump in on this issue of sort of the distinguishing these mechanisms on Ryan's paper? Want to jump in on that, Tom?
I would like to ask, how do we distinguish between actions on the part of states that are more or less driven by general cultural processes or more sort of coordinated, more sort of sophisticated norm platforms, entrepreneurs, more tangible mechanisms? Thanks.
And on this issue, right, we're all on the same script. Okay, Mike.
I think we're on the same script. It's a global script. I'm pretty sympathetic to the comments that Beth was giving, both in the idea that acculturation theory is very plausible, is probably happening, but also that it's hard to prove or disprove. And the comment that I wanted to make is whether the evidence that you invoke from Beth's book is actually evidence of acculturation or not in particular. So take the pattern that Beth finds, that your behavior is highly correlated with the behavior of other people in your region. Is that evidence for acculturation? Could be, but here's why it could be evidence for either of those two other mechanisms. So it could be evidence of persuasion or learning. Maybe countries infer or they learn what's optimal from observing what other neighbors in their region do. Could be optimal for their material interest, or it could be congruent with their values. So it seems very difficult to distinguish the learning effect from the acculturation effect. It's also difficult to distinguish from the material factors. So countries in a region, as Beth was saying, have some shared factors, some shared X's, which might cause a regional pattern in Y. Now, you might argue, and you seem to argue in the paper, that Beth controls for those X's and finds, after controlling for those X's, that region still has a big effect. In fact, an effect so big that it swamps the size of those X's. The answer back to that is that a regression that includes both X's and the regional pattern in Y will understate the effect of X, because it is tantamount to controlling for the consequence of an explanatory variable. If the X is a material factor that causes some behavior Y, signing a treaty, protecting human rights, and you control for that regional pattern in Y, then you're going to understate the effect of X. So the asymmetry that you find where the regional pattern is much more powerful than the X is exactly what we would expect if those X's were driving the regional pattern. Another way to put this is that there are going to be some aspect of my X that is correlated with the X's of other people in my region, and there's going to be some idiosyncratic aspect to my X that is not correlated with other people in my region. If you have a regression that includes my X and everyone else's Y, then the effect of X that we're estimating here is the idiosyncratic aspect of my X after parsing out the part of the X that I share with everyone else. So that's just to say that, I think that it's probably true that these acculturation mechanisms are operating, but the evidence that is invoked in this paper is, it can be interpreted in lots of different ways, and it could well be interpreted as supporting the power of the material or the persuasive mechanism just as easily as it could the acculturation mechanism.
I sort of agree and sort of disagree, but I'm gonna let Katarina. Is this on this, Katarina? Okay, go.
So I was wondering whether we can make theoretical and empirical progress on this by asking who exactly is acculturated. So in some of my other work, I look at regional similarities in employment, family, health laws in rich democracies, and argue that what elites know and love about the rest of the world isn't what ultimately matters, and what the small amount of information that gets to ordinary people about the rest of the world is what shapes policies. And I was wondering if we could extend this logic to the human rights arena. So it seems possible that constitutional court judges speak and talk to each other. That is observable. It's very, very clear that human rights lawyers talk, are fully acculturated with one another, talk primarily
to foreigners and so on. And it's not at all clear to me whether the decision makers who make the ultimate decision about treaty ratification, so the parliament, the members of parliament, talk much outside of their own, to people outside of their own country. So the theoretical question is, do you need the ultimate decision maker, the judge, the legislature, the executive, to be themselves acculturated, or is it enough for a theory of acculturation that a key constituency is fully acculturated? And if the latter, it seems very easy to look at how much people talk to each other, how much people talk to domestic audiences, how much they know about the rest of the world, to then test theories of acculturation.
Okay, we're still on this topic, are we? Yeah, Bessa.
Just going back to the evidence for persuasion versus acculturation, just thinking about the regional example of Europe and the notion of the newly democratizing states or the Western Europeans and so on mimic the others. Something that I found in my research is that they refer to Europe as a value and not just as a group, as a peer group that they want to identify with. So then there is a very strong overlap that, you know, to be a European or to do things as the advanced European states do seems to actually have a much more of a persuasive value, that they think there's an intrinsic value in being a European state, not just mimicking the others because it's very important and it's, you know, it's advancement, it's some sort of moral advancement. So then how would you, when you look at the evidence from Europe, then it presents a problem of whether they're persuaded by the idea of Europe versus mimicking, you know, advanced Europeans.
Okay, anybody else on this? I'm sorry, I don't know your name in the back. What is your name?
My name is Koz Deraya.
My comment or question is also related to the acculturization. And also, it is quite difficult to prove the acculturization, but as for the Japanese case, I think this comment paper is very persuasive. And so this is a traditional explanation, but one of the most persuasive explanation, and it is also we can prove by, for example, Japanese constitution in preamble have the such a term like the to seek a higher position in the world, and we also can check the editorials in the newspaper, and newspapers sometimes use the seeking for the better place in international society. And it also accords with the Japanese history as a modern state, I mean, to catch up the Western countries. So this shame or the honor element is important and could be evidence of actualization. And but having said that, I also wondering if this explanation is right, why some other human rights are not yet ratified, such as, for example, the most current issue in Japan is now ratification of Optional Protocol 1, but it is long been optional debated for a long time, but it was not yet possible. Optional Protocol 1 of the ICCPR. And so probably, as Katrina said, that there are other elements important, and some other element must be a limitation to limit the explanation of the this actualization theory. And this second point is just a comment, but the shamefulness or the seeking for the honor could be an obstacle to ratify the treaty, because it intends to be to establish higher threshold, and the people doesn't say, for example, that a student who have a much pride doesn't take examination for fear that they got a bad score. Japanese situation could be right like that. So that's my comment.
Okay, thank you. Zach, you had something on diffusion also, or on this acculturation?
think it's on this thread. And my general reaction to Ryan's paper was that it just made a lot of sense. And I actually have a lot of sympathy for the acculturation argument, just because I think in general that's how human beings behave, whether it's turning off your cell phone or whatever it is. And so I'm very sympathetic to it. And one reaction I had to it was that in some ways, reading your argument, Ryan, it just made so much sense, but it has a very sort of aggregate and abstract feel to it, in that it fits obviously any aspect of policy diffusion. But since you're talking specifically about treaty ratification, it sort of seems like you want to put actors' names on it. I think this is sort of what Katerina was saying. But if this is a situation in which parliaments are debating this, and I think that's generally the case. We can go to our constitutional data and see if that's the case. But if it is, obviously then you want to frame your argument, I think, in a more institutional way and actually talk about legislatures. And I think once you're in that realm, there are just a lot of options in terms of identifying specific hypotheses. And I think I'm gonna push back a little bit on Beth's comment as far as what you can get from transcripts of the deliberations of these legislatures, because I do think an acculturation argument has sort of a distinct profile. That there is a signature profile when you look at when you read a deliberation, that there you can identify things that look like an acculturation argument. For example, if nobody in, say, a deliberative session in the legislature mentions which other countries have ratified, or how many countries have ratified, if there's no mention of that, I think it's really hard to push an acculturation argument. I think there has to be. And obviously, in a qualitative way, you want to look at that deliberation more. But I think it manifests itself in a very overt way in those debates. And obviously, if you're looking at legislative debates, we know a lot about what those legislators otherwise think about human rights and a bunch of other things, because they've voted on a lot of other things. And so I think you can use the roll call vote. You can use an analysis of a combination of the transcript, the roll call vote, and how these legislators otherwise behave, to actually test some sort of micro stories within this. So in general, I think you need to, or might want to drill down a little bit to the actors and test some of those things. And I think there are other specific hypotheses. If you're looking in an aggregate fashion at how these things are adopted in the sequence, I think there's also sort of a signature to the acculturation argument, in that if you're looking at the X's, as Mike was mentioning, and also looking at the spatial lag, the neighborhood effect, the spatial lag should have more a stronger effect later in the sequence than it does in the earlier part of the adoption sequence. And if it does, or if it doesn't, I don't think acculturation is going on at all. But if it does, it means you can't rule it out, I think. And there are a number of other specific hypotheses, but I think you can do.
Okay, and Enrique. And this is the last one on this acculturation, and then we're gonna go back to the list, okay?
No, I was wondering, you could take persuasion and acculturation as two different ways of learning, a more reflexive way of learning and another one that is less reflexive and based most on process of habituation. And part of the democratization literature, there are some that tends to believe that, you know, democracy, institutionalization, the process of more of an unconscious habituation of practices, etc., and others that, you know, tend to rely on the side of persuasion. Or you could take them as two stages of a process of learning. You know, there's an initial reflective approach to certain norms that, you know, once it becomes problematized and incorporated, etc., then it recedes to the background and become, you know, part of a process of the life world, of the cultural traditions or political traditions of a region, of a country, etc. So you have a less reflexive relationship, but before you have a previous stage of reflexive incorporation of that issue.
All right, we're coming close to our time. We're done with that thread for now. And as much as I'd love to let you jump back in, and we're going to save you for the very end. Is that okay? And I want to return to three more people that are on the list. And if anybody else wants to say anything, just let me know. But I have Eric, Peter, and Geir. Eric. Malcolm?
Unfortunately, I'm going to go on the same thread. I won't repeat some points that I also wanted to make. Just two quick points. The first is not just about the regional effects, but also the other effects that if you include the greater degree to which a state is embedded in the international legal order increases the likelihood it will ratify a specific treaty. To me, that just shows that states that made similar decisions in the past continue to make those decisions. And, you know, it could be for acculturation reason, it could be for anything. And like Mike, I worry not just about sort of interpreting the interpretation of these coefficients, but also throwing them into the model without sort of a clear sense of sort of why they're in there and what they're doing and what effect they might have on other coefficients of interest. I do worry about that same issue. On sort of how you show this, to me, the way forward is not to think about sort of how to find a new variable or how to within this sort of framework of treaty ratification. I think the way to move forward on this is to evaluate policy innovations that are specifically targeted at a social influence, right? So we have lots of attempts to shame states that are not conformed to human rights norms in a social way. You could evaluate if those work. There's other efforts, especially within the UN context, that are really targeted, that are almost based on the theory of acculturation. So you could evaluate whether they actually lead to behavioral changes. And I think that might be a more useful approach, because that immediately sort of puts you within the realm of policy recommendations and sort of implications that I think might be more meaningful than trying to deal with these sort of multiple interpretations of the same variables.
Okay, and now we have, okay, we are going to go on now to Peter. All right, we're on to Gar.
Yes, some comments on Julia and to Beth, not so surprisingly. The first is yes, no, we should probably have examined what are the implications or the what we can expect of implication of ratifying. But I think that ratifying treaties are inherently risky business, because you can try to examine what are the future implications, but you're not sure, because it may depend partly on differences in interpretation among different lawyers, and you may also have international institutions that may have different opinions, which we have heard may change over time. So it is impossible in a way to foresee all the consequences, and then it may also be some unintended consequences which are impossible to foresee. And of course, with increasing power to international institutions, we have all the questions of legitimacy and so on, which we will not go into. But I think it's risky business to ratify treaties. Another thing is the inclusiveness in different phases of negotiation of a treaty and the ratification and implementation. If it's only a segment of society or specialists being involved in negotiation and ratification, and then afterwards you open the debate for all of the society, then there may be some surprises that the society does not want to accept what was negotiated and ratified. So I think that may have happened also in this case. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, there may be changes in society that something that was acceptable at the point of ratification is no longer acceptable at the point of implementation. And I think that may also be part of the explanation, a certain backlash in Norway concerning human rights, partly because of the implications that you see here, but also in other treaties. Which I think is reflected, at least the backlash in certain quarters, and an indication is also a white paper from the government about Norwegian foreign policy, which is not only about values, but now it should also be interests, values and interests, which may not be surprising for other states, but in Norway it has been values is the big thing. Mm-hmm. So there may be different explanations.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. Malcolm.
I'll start with a CRC paper to be different. There is something special about this convention, and I think it's important, but I may be pushing back against Jose here. And when I was looking at the media discourse results, in Norway I found with international covenants, civil and political rights, they were way above everybody else, around 600 references in the media. It doubled for the European Court. Then I went to the Convention on the Rights of the Child, 6,000 references to this convention in the last 10 years. And I've just done a few quick other tests in other media. And this convention is operating at a completely different level in terms of political discourse. So is this because, does this conform with what Jose says, because there's so much wiggle room, there's so much more debate, or is it the completely opposite, that this is actually a revolutionary treaty that's actually really pushed the boundaries because children are suddenly rights bearers and it's actually a very hard treaty? And does these special features actually mean that you should be looking at another treaty in the region to capture maybe the very specific effects of this treaty? The second thing is you use this word translate, and it immediately made me think about the whole field of conceptual history, and Reinhard Kozelek and Quentin Skinner, who say you cannot translate a concept across time, across space, and across language accurately. It's always moving, which has real implications when we're looking at consequences, effectiveness, but also the theories of acculturation, because meaning is constantly changing and spreading. So in fact, what we're conforming to in one place may be very different from other ways. So maybe we need to bring in linguistics as another way of checking this entire project, particularly because we're dealing at a universal basis. And lastly, on acculturation, separating the ratification stage and the implementation stage, Ryan went to the international to sort of push back against Beth, but no one's mentioned sub-regional and the Eurovision theory of state behaviour, which is, if you follow the Eurovision Song Contest, what will you see in the voting patterns? Very, very strong sub-regional patterns. So Norway votes for Swinland, Denmark and Iceland. The Balkans, they've been fighting each other, you know, like cats and dogs, but they all vote for each other in the Eurovision. What this may say, that when it comes particularly to implementation, we look sub-regionally. And I've discovered in Norway the best argument for getting reform through is Sweden's done it. But this may not operate at the ratification stage. So the acculturation effect may be at much more at that sub-regional level, and that may be something to investigate more.
So the best argument is no longer Norway's done it. No. Okay. And we have Basal.
Just a brief comment on Enrique's and Jen's paper in terms of the suggestions that you were asking to expand, and I would actually think it would be very valuable to go outside of Latin America or South America, or however phrased. You justify in the paper and you say, well, we're looking at domestic dynamics because it really makes sense in the region. But if you sort of went out of that context, say coming back to the Council of Europe kind of context, where you have the EU conditionality really driving not ratification processes, but also implementation processes as well. And then I don't know if it's a separate variable or whether it becomes part of the coalition, that you actually have an external actor that's not civil society, domestic or state or intergovernmental, but actually also drives and becomes a very complex actor in the implementation. And they push for some implementation issues and not for others. So they're present in some cases and not in others. So I think the moment you go out of Latin America, that picture of the variables would change, not necessarily in every instance, but in instances where you have international or external actors or other states driving the implementation process. Norway driving the implementation process in Azerbaijan, for example, where they have a lot of oil companies and a lot of human rights NGOs, for example.
Okay, can I just put one other quick thing on the table, and that is I just wanted to sort of, there is this part of Ryan's paper also that talks about the strategic theories are the same pretty much as acculturation theories, that unless there's acculturation, you can't have really strategic behavior because there's nothing motivating you to be strategic unless you want to fit in or something like that. And I actually agree with that point. I think there's a huge amount of overlap for the strategic kind of a behavior and for the sort of acculturation account, because there's some mysteries too, because the strategic behavior of ratification It does sort of depend on this kind of a psychic cost. The thing is, it's subject to some of the criticisms that you've made about, what happens when the community of countries realizes that you're insincere, right? Does the psychic cost that you're bearing, just go back up if you're discovered in a thick information environment to be insincere in your ratification? So I'm wondering if it's kind of futile, isn't it, to some way try to match yourself with everybody else to avoid criticism in anything but the shortest term, because you'll be bearing these psychic costs again once everybody figures out that you're not sincere about this kind of thing. So I guess I wonder, strategic theories put a lot of emphasis on information structure and your time horizons. I wonder how those two things fit into an acculturation account. I'm just sort of wondering about that. But there is this clear similarity that they're both based on this idea that you have to be worried about what others think about you in order to take even some of the strategic actions I'm talking about. All right, so, yes.
I think that that this mechanism of how acculturation interacts both with other mechanisms as well as how it works itself is, maybe I'm just ignorant, but it seems to be horribly under-theorized. And so another dimension of this problem which occurs to me is that, we've got exactly what mechanism by which a policy is adopted or the states become signatories is sort of arbitrary. I mean, is it just individuals who feel that they need to acculturize who also happen to be influential are the ones signing these things? Or is there some kind of social process that goes on in which groups en masse are acculturalized in a similar way and then apply political pressure accordingly? Or is it just something that happens to the country en masse and so that it becomes part of the zeitgeist without anybody actually talking to anybody? So I'm just wondering about how this aggregation mechanism is supposed to go on that then generates the kind of policy outcomes that we're actually talking about. That's it, yeah.
Okay, alrighty. I think the floor is closed, and it's open now only to our panelists, and then we'll conclude. So in the order in which the presentations were made, Ryan, do you want to go first?
Sure, I'll try to cover as much ground as
don't
I can
feel like
in a very short period of time. just a few points at the outset. One is, from a methodological standpoint, not every case can be shown to be acculturation or not. So you can throw up a case and say, what about the EU membership? Or what about why we wear certain things we wear? And the answer would be, methodologically, it's going to be impossible to distinguish between persuasion and acculturation. So you just can't do it in every case that one throws up. The idea is to demonstrate in those cases in which one can arbitrate based on the evidence. Second is, not every case of human rights will necessarily be explained by acculturation or anything like it. We even have an element of acculturation that isn't overwhelmed by domestic factors or the like, so trafficking might be a case of that. One would have to theorize about what are the preconditions or conditions for acculturation to work, one of which is the institutionalization of the norm. And maybe trafficking just has not been institutionalized, and that would also, in a way, starts to suggest how I think it could be disproven. And then in answer to Beth saying, I'm not saying you're one of them, I guess my retort is, I'm saying you are. You're one of us. So the idea is that the book is itself comes out with, and I think that's one of the, and you've seen me present on your book before, so I've said this before, it's not just in response, that Beth is so honest and candid about the theoretical explanations that do not necessarily align with her bottom line conclusion, that there are many parts of the book in which you yourself say, there's affirmative evidence here for social influence. And those are the parts that I'm kind of putting together with some additional parts in which you say it's not evidence of socialization, and I think it still is through the strategic lens. And because you yourself do that is where it could be disproven. So I do think that it can be disproven in many ways. So the embeddedness question, it's not that embeddedness proves acculturation, but if that was not the correlation, it would disprove it. So it's just like causation. We're not necessarily, correlation doesn't prove causation, but if there wasn't the correlation, it would disprove causation for many a theory. Then just to lump together Katarina and Zach's point about the actors. And I agree. I think that case studies might get between the ears. So it is about justifications that people make, especially if the case study includes archives that were not for public consumption. So foreign ministries debating about whether or not to ratify a convention. And that's the part that's important. It's not just whether or not outside in the world there is, in fact, a norm that's being created. But I agree that if there's no mention of the norm, then I would say that disproves it as well. So that's about the perception that it's either real or imagined. Those actors have to imagine it, even if they might misunderstand the consensus, because the European Court of Human Rights has told them there's a European consensus. Well, there's not really one. But they then refer to the European Court saying that. That's part of the perception. It might be the legislatures. I think that's one of the actors. Foreign ministries, obviously, and judges. So I also think when you can interrogate a judicial opinion, the ways in which, as I mentioned, some of the conservative constitutional law scholars have with respect to the juvenile death penalty case and the Texas sodomy law decision, that the judges really are not interacting with the opinions of their foreign counterparts, as Anne-Marie Slaughter suggests they are. It's not that they're being persuaded. They are counting. And it's about a world trend that's influencing their decision and actually holds them in disrepute with some of their stakeholders or constituents. So Justice Kennedy does not do well when he circulates back into the Federalist Society. But that's the justification on the face. I think there's more reason to believe that that's the justification that they have. Just some other ways in which one would disprove it, besides those kinds of case study approaches, are the independent variables. So I think that one of them is about whether or not in the region, is it just a learning process because there are congruent values in the region? So Mike's question. Then the indicators are whether or not the world indicators are better explanations than the national indicators. And in fact, if an educational curriculum is being adopted to educate kids in a way that does not track national level indicators of either development or elite structures within those communities, or the fact that kids are being educated in ways that are mimicking industrialized societies, but it's an agrarian society, or the ways in which, if that's spreading also so that you see world shifts and you might see regional shifts with standard deviations shrinking over time, and those are a better explanation and there's more rapid change according to the world shift and not according to the national indicators, that's part of the explanation that I think can lead to ways we prove or disprove the effect of acculturation. Lastly is Tom's point about how does decoupling on its own do it. I think that that's right. I should qualify it. It's decoupling with isomorphism, so the spread of homogenized forms plus something. So those plus somethings are going to arbitrate between materialist explanations or persuasion-based explanations. And some of it is about persistent decoupling, that there's no real good explanation as to why the state would maintain certain structures, because it's either against its material interest. So these are about creating administrative bureaucracies that are not in line with material interests are extremely costly, but they maintain that over time. You would think that they would update their learning as a Bayesian updating at the very least. It's also about solutions chasing problems, so states adopting environmental set-asides, and they don't even have that level of environmental degradation. So that's David John Frank's work. And then there's another work that's an empirical study with an independent variables and statistical analysis, Mark Sussman's work on what's a good predictor of states buying supersonic aircraft, and it's not correlated with the degree to which they have a regional threat.
Not even a runway.
Not even a runway. Well, it's actually correlated. Well, at least they can put in an air show is part of the idea. So they can put in an air show, and it is correlated with their embeddedness in the international community. But you can't explain it through a persuasion-based account. And then obviously they're the funny ones, like states having a navy and they're landlocked. But I don't need to go any further with that. Another one of solutions chasing problems is obviously Martha Finnemore's work in international organization on UNESCO and national science bureaucracies, where I think the modal category for a state adopting a national science bureaucracy is when R&D is less than 0.7% of its GDP and it has less than 10 scientists or something like that in the country. But the greater explanation is its embeddedness and understanding the persuasive message of social influence that was conveyed to them that this is what a modern state does.
Okay, and now the second paper would be Enrique and Jean.
Yeah, Well, thanks very much for the comments. I mean, I'll just pick up, I think, just a couple of them because there were a lot, and some of them I think are easier to go away and think about than others. But actually, I'd like to start with Malcolm's point about the Convention on the Rights of the Child being a revolutionary convention. And I think perhaps that does mean that it does need to be dealt with separately from other conventions. A lot depends, of course, on what you're looking to do. You're looking to kind of think about the consequences of ratification of this convention, or you're trying to think about the consequences of ratifying multiple conventions in particular places. And I think there is an argument for separating out the Convention on the Rights of the Child, for all kinds of reasons. One of the things that is also very plain, if you think about the convention, is that the consequences of ratification ought to be felt not just in, well, transitional countries. It implies an awful lot of policy change, not just in transitional democracies, but actually in full democracies, in one way or another. And I mean, I'm aware of this thinking about some other work I'm doing, which picks up a point that Bassett's making. One of the things I'm looking at the moment is about the EU's policies of promotion and protection of children's rights, specifically what the Commission is trying to do in terms of promoting and protecting children's rights or persuading member states to do so. And one of the things that's very plain coming out of that work is that the Commission just doesn't know what minimum compliance means. They have no shared understanding in the Commission about what that would mean for member states. And that makes me very, very reluctant to kind of pick up that suggestion that you made for the paper, that what it actually needs is a definition of what minimal compliance is. I'm not sure that is the point of this paper, or that it would be particularly helpful to do that, because it's very plain that what compliance is being interpreted to mean has got an awful lot to do with what the state of children, of the position of children in society is in particular places. So, for example, when we're going to be thinking about children's rights, say in the UK, we may well be thinking about the convention having a lot of traction around issues of children in detention, children unaccompanied minors, children in the asylum system. That obviously isn't going to really have a lot of traction in some other places. So I think from the perspective of the cases, there's a lot to be said for thinking about compliance in terms of how does that agenda shape up in particular cases. What do relevant actors see as the agenda for compliance, given that, as we were all in agreement, that actually this is such a difficult convention to determine what compliance is going to actually mean. So that's, I think, my first point. I think there are questions to be picked up from other points you were making around sincerity of states. I don't know if Enrique wants to say something about that.
Thanks for the comment, and thank you, Jose, for very useful comments and criticisms. And I think it's useful that we should place the Convention of the Rights of the Child within a broader typology of conventions, and therefore we're dealing with a different type of convention that leads to a more politically charged process. So I would say, well, maybe it's other sorts of convention, they fit more into what I previously worked on, political social accountability, that you control whether the state is abiding by the law or violating a certain law, etc. So your politics revolves around demands for legal accountability. But here, given the nature of the process, whether it is revolutionary or because it's unclear in its provisions, well, it's an issue of political accountability, not only making sure that the state abides by the law or not, but what is the content of that law, and therefore it distinguishes this type of convention from other types, and therefore this this is a subset of compliant politics as well, that is more politically charged than other politics. I think it's a very good suggestion. And I think that given the nature of this treaty, it's more difficult, and I agree here, wishing to establish a baseline for measuring, because then we could go back maybe to a legal issue of accountability that actually leaves aside, you know, the political nature, the highly political nature of the treaty. I agree with you also on more general problems of addressing more general problems of compliance in certain society, that, you know, some societies have a problem with compliance with the law in general, whether it is global, regional, or domestic. And I think, you know, we've been addressing this decision on the politics of social accountability, etc. So in this case, you know, you could extend this to the global arena, that the problem of compliance is a more generalized problem. I think this is a good point. On the process before, yeah, I agree that it's important. And actually, we made this argument and we had this emphasis on the original article on Argentina. And actually, maybe we should emphasize it more on this article. And actually, our argument is that before actually the ratification of the convention, there was no domestic advocacy. And actually, the contribution of the process of state ratification was, well, it forced to the creation of a domestic compliance coalition where before it did not exist to one. So it was actually instrumental in starting this process. So I think we should emphasize this before in the, or strengthen this argument for the other cases. We have to think more, yeah, on the sincere and false ratifier. I think it is important. Sorry, you want to. It is important, I think, at the launching, you know, the process of ratification and at the initial stage of ratification, but I think it launches a process of politics of compliance. I might be less relevant, you know, after the initial moments of ratification, etc.
Okay. Yeah, the only thing I would add on that business of sincerity, non-sincerity, is that I've never read it. I mean, perhaps you can tell me I'm wrong here, but I've never read it to imply that all elements of the state necessarily are in agreement with ratification. That is, but for many bits of the state, it's not even a relevant question to ask, are you in agreement with ratification? And for other bits, well, even if they're not going to be influential in the debate over whether ratification happens. So I don't see that necessarily as suggesting that, you know, you have to disaggregate the state at the point of ratification. No. But I think you probably do have to disaggregate the state when it comes to thinking about how the agenda of compliance actually unfolds, because certain state agencies are going to be very influential in debates about specific bits of rights. Gotcha. And maybe even able to obstruct the delivery of certain kinds of rights.
Good. Okay. And finally, Anna Julia.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. No, it's a fascinating story, this. How come they didn't foresee the consequences? Well, this is based speculations, but we may see a case of wishful thinking here. We may see a case where the desire to be able to ratify was so strong that it actually caused the belief that it was possible to ratify. So we shouldn't assume rationality, I think. This may equally well, perhaps more plausibly, be irrational. It's impossible to make reservations in these conventions. So that was not an option. But what Norway could have done, but didn't do, what was Denmark did in 1996 when it ratified the same convention, namely sending to the ILO an explicit statement about how Denmark understood the issue of land rights on Greenland. Yeah, yeah. And that was actually suggested by the Ministry of Justice in Norway, but it was never done. And exactly why it was never done, maybe they didn't believe it was possible. Maybe they felt so sure of their own interpretation of what this actually implied that they deemed this unnecessary. Because there was this statement at the end of the negotiations by a joint Nordic intervention that stated how the Nordic states understood what they actually had agreed on. And that was so, they were obviously aware of the fact that these articles would be contested after ratification. So this was one effort at trying to secure the Nordic understanding of what they actually had agreed on. And that was also included in the document that formed the basis of the National Parliament's decision to recommend ratification. But that is, again, and that is interesting in terms of how unintended consequences, because these documents are not included in the basis when Geir interpreted these articles. He didn't include this special statement by the Nordic representatives. When the International Law Group, appointed by the Sami Rights Commission, interpreted what is implied by the Article 14, they also didn't include references to this particular statement. So this has to do with traditions of interpretations among international lawyers. So that's an additional element, I think. Simply has to do with international law as a discipline.
Okay, so, well, I think we've seen the benefits and challenges of friendly interdisciplinary discussion. And so I would like to thank so much the paper givers for three good papers. And also, Jose, thank you very much for coming for your comments as well.